Hello and welcome to this chess video with me. I'm Fidemaster Ingvar Jóhannesson, also known here as Sibbit. And yes, this was the last round in the Croatia Grand Chess Tour. I think it's no secret that Magnus Carlsen ran through this field with plus five. And this is his last round game against Maxim Vasir Lagrav, or MVL, as he's often referred to in the chess world. Two of the absolute best players in the world. Magnus Carlsen, of course, world number one, world champion. And after this game, he has tied his highest ever rating of 2882. I said in an earlier video that he needed 2.5 out of 3 to break it. He got 2 out of 3 to tie it. So the next classical tournament, he again has a chance to break his own record. And I guess road to 2900. I mean, what else is there left? But let's move on to the game. When you play against Maxim Vasir Lagrav, he's a very principled player, and you can almost take for certain that he will play his openings. So if you play e4, you will most likely get a knight off. If you play d4, he's ready to battle you in a Grunfeld. So he has tremendous experience in these lines. And Magnus, he plays d4 and decides to take on the Grunfeld. In recent years, it seems like people have been going for all these kind of anti-Grunfelds, maybe starting with c4, maybe playing some early h4s, playing these f3 lines. But Magnus, he goes for the good old main lines. He plays knight f3, takes on d5, and plays e4. And I did a quick database search, and the only like true high level game in 2019 in this position, mind you, my database is up to date until June, and the only game was Grishuk against Nepomniachtchi from the Grand Prix. There was one other game. Let's see if I have it. Andrikian against Jones, but that was a rapid game. Le Quang Liam against Ding Liren, that was in the Pro Chess League, not a classical game. So it seems like people have been shying away from the Grunfelds, the consensus being that black is just okay in the Grunfeld. But Magnus goes for the main line, Queen f5, the main move, and Queen d2. And if I'm not mistaken, this is something that Kramnik liked to play here against the Grunfeld. Knight c6 now, and rook b1, which has been established as the main move here, and this contains a threat, rook to b5, simply winning the pawn. So the main moves are a6, or what MVL did, clarifying the situation in the center, c takes d4. But this more or less forces a queen trade. Either black takes on d2, or allows white to take on a5. In the game, MVL castled, but queen takes d2, white will probably take with the king. And it's noteworthy that Peter Swidler, one of the absolute experts in the Grunfeld as well, played this line successfully with white, going for this endgame here. But MVL, he castled in the game. So short castles. Magnus took an a5, and I guess he was quite happy with this. And his intention was, with the tournament situation, a draw was fine for him. So he wanted to maybe play a little, but without risk. And he felt like he wasn't risking much in this Grunfeld endgame. Bishop to d4, Magnus castled. And now a novelty by MVL, which Magnus criticized a little. MVL played bishop takes f3. There was a previous game by Sutowski with black here against Markus Racker, where he played rook after d8. But there he also took an f3, and Racker actually won a very nice game, utilizing the power here of his light squared bishop and a protected passed pawn on e6. Something went wrong here for black. But Emil played bishop takes f3, pawn takes, and first e6 to restrict white center here. White has a strong center, but black wants to restrict it here and then attack it. Perhaps on the d-file. So rook f d1, rook f to d8, attacking d4, so everything seems to be going according to plan for black. Bishop to f1. And now b6. This move feels natural in a way, but also maybe it's not necessary yet, and it seems to give white a little bit of a free hand, especially on the c-file. Now the bishop that just retreated to f1 now goes back to a6, and this gives white unfiltered access to the c-file if he so pleases. But MVL plays rook d6, and his idea is clear. After rook b to c1, he'll play rook d8 and attack the weak d4 pawn. And it looks like we can't really protect it. Note that if you play e5, I will take it, and of course there's a pin on the d-file, so we can't do that. Advancing the pawn, I will take it, but Magnus has a tactical solution. Plays bishop to g5. This attacks the rook, and well, you can't really move the rook because of the back rank issues here, and maybe bishop h6, maybe bishop b5 first. The rook has to move, and now you can play bishop h6, and there's no defense here. Well, there was rook. Yeah. No, this works. So therefore, MVL played f6, but now the bishop retreats, and we've cut off the diagonal of this bishop by forcing the pawn to f6. Okay, black would like to play f5, which he didn't do, but if you play f5, I will go again to g5. Rook at d7, and I will hassle you like this. The rook doesn't have a very good square, and next I can maybe play e5 and take this pawn. So this is out of the question, and explains also the move h6. So black wants to play f5. Bishop to b5. I thought, yeah, maybe knight c6 was an option here instead of h6. I think that's what Magnus said under pressure, but still it's an unpleasant position for black. It's only white that can press in these positions. And we again see an example of Magnus just using the power of the bishop pair tremendously. We saw this game against Ding Liren, where he had the black pieces and utilized the power of the bishops tremendously. So now f5. Again, now it looks like we have this attack on d4 again, but once again Magnus has a tactical solution. He plays d5, which seems to hang the pawn if black takes, which MVL did not do. But if you do take, he takes d5, bishop f4. And since you took on d5, we no longer have e6 to e5 available, so you have to move the rook. But now the power of the bishops just becomes tremendous. First they attack the rook on d8 and then take on d5, and as you can see, there's little black can do to prevent the d pawn from simply queening in a few moves. So after d5, MVL played g5, preventing bishop to f4. But then Magnus found a new avenue for the bishop, bishop to d2. And now if you take on d5, it's going to be a similar line, but on the other side. First, MVL took on e4 and played a6. So again, if you take on d5, bishop b4, and you have no squares. You can take on d5 with a pawn, but rook takes d5 is actually quite strong. And you either have to take on d5 or give me the passer, or allow both of my rooks to come to the 7th, which, as most people know, is tremendously strong. So MVL played a6, trying to lure the bishop away from this diagonal, which would allow him to take on d5. But bishop a4, keeping the bishop on this diagonal, he takes d5, and now we actually have this line that we just looked at, very similar. Rook takes d5 is the strongest move MVL took, but now the power of the bishops and the d-pawn, the very strong d-pawn, very often an important factor in the Grunfeld, and so important that in a famous Grunfeld book by Jonathan Rawson, he even named this d-pawn, called it Delroy the d-pawn. And well, we had other people name their pawns. I'm not going to name any names, but they do call their h-pawns Harry. So now rook e4. Attacking the bishop, a3, no, rook c8 first, check, and then a3. Of course, king h7 is met with bishop to c2, so king f7. did I say king f7 instead of king h7? Maybe I did, but it's just what happens sometimes. Bishop e5, trying to cover c7, bishop e8, king g7, and now Delroy starts to move. Rook d4, getting behind the pawn, but it's too late. The pawn is getting too dangerous. We're threatening the queen now. And yeah, you also have to deal with the threat of bishop c3 in some cases lining up here. Amuel went knight b7, but simply bishop e7, and just too little too late. Amuel went for some kind of trick here with rook e4, but even if you fall for a trick, it should be winning. Although if you queen, and let's say you take with the bishop, you do give black some outside chances of making a draw here with two pieces for two pawns for the piece, but still should be winning. But Magnus was having none of this and played rook c6, bishop d4, bishop takes h2 is not working here because we will simply take on b6. Well, not simply, and then play here, knight e6, and black is just helpless here. Let's say you, I was trying to take on e6 and then queen, so you have to move the knight here, but then I attack it, and then I have another pawn, and the pieces are just tied down here, completely lost. Emil played bishop d4, but after rook to c7 attacking the knight, which doesn't have a square, we are simply going to queen, and the game will be over. So taking the bishop would simply allow this, and you can't defend the queen on the next move without giving up your rook, and game over. So Magnus wins yet another tournament, and his current run is actually unbelievable. He has won 8 tournaments now in a row. And I think I have them here, as tweeted by Tarje Svensson. He won the World Blitz Championship, he won Tata Steel, Granka Chess, Shamkir Chess, Abidjan, the first super tournament in Africa. He won Lindores Abbey in Scotland, Norway Chess, and now Croatia Grand Chess Tour. And this magnificent run has featured, I think now, well over 70 games undefeated, and in the last 190 days he is plus 54, 55 draws and 3 losses. A surreal year for the world champion, and it's only early July. So Magnus is definitely cementing his GOAT status, I guess. It's very hard to argue against Magnus being the greatest ever. I mean, some people will, of course, continue the fight, just like in the NBA, you know, it's LeBron James, no, it's Michael Jordan, man. But yeah, I would say at least three people have a case: Fischer, Kasparov, and Carlsen. Some people will say Karpov as well, but I think Carlsen is the best ever, and that's the way it is. So now, yeah, like we mentioned at the start of the video, he is now 28-82 again, equaling his record, and maybe he'll break it in the next tournament, who knows. But we will certainly watch and eagerly await to see what happens then. But I will see you in another chess video, and until then, bye bye.